Here we go. Shortly before our panel discussion on what can we do to avoid the point of no return. And I have with me here Larry Fink, the chairman of BlackRock, the biggest money manager in the world. Larry, you just sent a letter to all the CEOs in the world on sustainability with very clear messages. When was a tipping point for you that you thought sustainability is so important that I, as a money manager, as an asset manager, have to put pressure on the world CEOs?
Well, I've done these letters now for 8 years, and my purpose is not to put pressure. My purpose is to really inform our clients, as the largest manager of retirement assets in the world, our clients are interested in long-term outcomes. It's not about the moment, it's not about a trade. So 8 years ago, I began writing letters about the need of long-termism, the need to change the narrative from the moment-by-moment dialogues that we see in financial media and television. All they talk about, does the market go up and down? And the reality is, that is so unimportant for 30-year outcomes like retirement. So the letters began as a conversation about long-termism. And now for the last 8 years, they're all components of long-termism. In 2018, my letter really spoke about how do you create long-term profitability? And the only way you can create long-term profitability is through being a purposeful company. So I introduced that whole concept of purpose. It's more than just profits. It's more about if you focus on the purpose of how you deal with your clients, your employees, the relationship you have in the communities where you're operating, if you can do that well over time, you're going to have even more resilient profitability. So I said in my 2019 letter that purpose and profit equal each other. They're not against each other.
And now you followed up in 2020 on sustainability.
And so over the course of the last few years, and most importantly in the last 10 months, it was very clear to me that more and more of my conversation with our clients was how should they be thinking about climate change in a portfolio setting. As I said, our clients are looking for outcomes 10 plus years. And if we have actual physical risk to our portfolio, how are we going to navigate that? And so it became very clear to me that more and more clients worldwide, whether you're a client in Texas or China or Saudi Arabia, worldwide clients have been asking us about this whole idea of climate change and the impact. And it was very clear to me now we are starting to see more and more demand for this type of idea. And the one beauty of the capital markets, of finance, when we identify a problem, we bring the problem forward. And that's the tipping point. There's a tipping point in finance. There's a tipping point now in capitalism that we are now beginning to see a real major reallocation of capital. We're having investors who are focusing on more sustainable strategies. We're having clients focus on how do they best prepare for themselves for a world that is going to be more impacted on climate change. And I believe this is going to be a really major change in how we all do business.
Just take a short look. You talked about long-termism. What is your personal view on climate change? How much time do we really have for this process?
I'm not a scientist. I've read many scientific journals. So it's not a, I don't think it's important what I think. I think what I'm trying to say, whether you believe in 5% of the science or 100% of the science, or if you believe the science is not pessimistic enough, more and more clients are in need of understanding that impact. And I do believe there is obviously more events that are going on in the world that is pretty hard to explain other than that we are seeing physical impact in the world today. And I believe through that process, whether it is the bushfires of Australia or the droughts of Southern Africa that are horrific right now, or the frequency of hyperstorms, or we're seeing, in some areas, we're seeing rising heat, and we're seeing plants germinating way before pollinators are arriving. I mean, I could go on and all the different impacts that we're seeing that may be small in scope, but massive in outcome. And so we believe every investor who's focusing on retirement, focusing on 10, 20, 30, 40-year outcomes, have to be better prepared. They have to design their portfolio. And it's going to mean moving from moving to different industries. But let me just also say in my letter, the carbon transition is a 50-year process. We need to make sure that we are not succumbing to some of the elements that are saying we need to be decarbonized tomorrow. Because parts of the world, like in Asia, they're going to be building 1,000 coal plants tomorrow. We need to make sure that we build, that we decarbonize as fast as possible, but we do that in a fair and just way. What I worry about, and I wrote this in my letter, is the political impact. We're seeing the rise of populism, and we're seeing political leaders who are focusing on those people whose needs have not been met. And maybe they've been impacted by some form of decarbonization, or they may be impacted by more and more regulation against, let's say, steel manufacturing or other things like that. And so you're having politicians who are trying to appeal to those people's issues, their fears. We have to come up with a global solution. We can't have one nation, one continent focus on it. It's just not going to work in a holistic way. And I write in my letter, if we have to get business and government working together, we need to be challenged. We need to be responding together. When in my 44 years in business, I've witnessed five major crises in the capital markets, but they're all financial in nature. And we have a network of central banks who work together, who are organized, and they have stabilized the world repeatedly. Climate change, we do not have an international body.
But Larry, you say in your letter, governments must take the lead. What happens if they don't?
And then we will have more negative outcomes. I mean, I don't say governments, I say we all need to take the lead. Governments and companies, we need to do it together. We can turn the problems of climate change into a positive. If we all came together and we all started using private capital to build infrastructure to be prepared for that, private capital to be working with utilities to decarbonize sooner, to building out more solar and more hydro and more renewable types of energies, this has the ability to be mitigated quite considerably if we work together. And the bigger problem is, how do we get to the if?
Okay, but let's assume that you don't work together and you as an asset manager with $7 trillion in assets under management have a lot of power. What can you do now that this transition moves ahead much faster?
So let's be clear. Every asset that we have on behalf, it's not our money. None of this is BlackRock's money. This is our clients' hard-earned money, whether it's a pension fund or somebody's savings. As I said, we're the largest retirement manager. Our job is to inform and to identify. I write these letters to our clients so they can think about this. We want to inform our clients. But what we're trying to do, what I said in the letter, we're offering much more transparency. We're going to talk about how we vote much more transparently now on various
So this will AGM. Be a hot AGM season for many CEOs next year? This year?
No, this year we're not saying we want everybody to, we didn't give enough time for most companies to make those changes. But over the course of the 2021 AGM for 20, that's when we expect to see better transparency. We expect companies reporting under SASB, under TCFD. So we're looking for greater transparency with more companies. And as I said, we're not running away from hydrocarbons because we don't have an economic alternative in some of the areas. Now, we certainly do for sunlight and solar. But one of the big facts that people don't talk about, only 18% of humanity has flown in an airplane. It is estimated by 2030, 30% of humanity is going to fly in an airplane. That's going to be doubling of the airplane usage. And we don't have technology to have renewable energy airplanes. So we don't have technology for a lot of very large combustible, type of engines. And so we have to be managing this and navigating. And as much as we've been doing in the renewable space, 20 years ago, the world energy use, 80% of the energy use came from hydrocarbons. Today, 80%. So because the vast change that's going on in the emerging world, as they're growing, they're using more and more coal to electrify and all that. So you know, we still have a significant issue, and we need to address this. And there may have to be multiple different solutions. Maybe the developed world has one solution, but knowledgeable about what does it mean for the developing world. As I said, if we don't have a fair and just solution, we're not going to have a solution.
But let me be very bold with my question.
Yeah.
You write these letters, yeah, and I don't know if CEOs are looking forward to it or afraid of it.
But I don't write to them for that reason.
But writing them is not enough. What else will BlackRock do exactly to facilitate
if
that change?
We're asking companies to provide greater transparency to move forward. I believe transparency is going to make companies move more towards that objective. But I would say last and foremost, BlackRock can't do it alone. We're not here to say we could do it alone, but I do believe more and more CEOs who I've spoken to are moving forward faster. And so I think we are going to have the business community moving forward faster. What I'm worried about, I don't see the government moving as fast as the business community. And there lies the problem. We cannot
do
it alone.
You need a level playing field.
Well, I think this is going to be the big issue for Europe. Europe is actually in front of this. And the question is, does it make Europe uncompetitive against the rest of the world? So Europe needs to build hope, not just on climate change. It needs to build hope for young people and getting great jobs and great opportunities. This is not just a simplistic thing that we could identify climate change as one problem. That problem is interconnected with everything else that we have in society. But the most important thing, we need to make climate change not a problem, but we need climate change and the reduction and the way we mitigate climate change an opportunity to build economic wealth and economic gains for more.
Thank you so much, Larry. It's great to have you here. Thank you for being our guest at Deutsche Bank. This was our interview with Larry Fink from BlackRock, the chairman and CEO of BlackRock.